A very good morning to all of you. Greetings from WFM Media and McCoy Sodal and SNP. Today we're going to talk about sealants and applications for interiors. It's looking like a nice day. Every day looks like a nicer day than yesterday. And the funny part is we all have to stay home. That's the sad part of life. My name is Amit Malhotra. I lead McCoy Sodal. And unfortunately, we have to live with this for the next few weeks, few months, and such is life. I now pass this webinar on to Nitin Patyal, who will take the webinar going forward. Nitin, over to you.
Thank you, Amit. Good morning to everybody, ladies and gentlemen. I sincerely hope that there are a couple of ladies also who could, who must be attending our seminars and the webinars. Today's topic is the importance of interior contracting and then use of sealants, foams and adhesives in interior contracting. Interior contracting has been a subject, a lot of time we talk about finish, we talk about material, we talk about quality, we talk about, a lot of other factors. But what is the science behind it? That's why we have, the panelists with us. Moving forward, those panelists will take care of the subject which they are going to talk about. We have two presenters and four panelists. Sandeep Chaudhary is from Rishield and he's running another business of waterproofing. We have an architect, Mr. Anish Kumar, and then who does a lot of projects and in practice from last 11 years with Dinova. And we have Gopal also from McCoy Sodal, who is an expert on sealant, foams, and adhesives. So that's a brief introduction about the panelists and the presenters. I would not take much of time and would not introduce you to the technology and about the product range they are going to talk about. So I will start sharing the screen. I will hand over the panel to Anish. So Anish, I am going to share this with you. And you can start your presentation. Over to you, Anish.
Can you see the screen?
Yes, we can. You can put it on the slide mode.
Thank you, Nitin. Day in, day out, I have been doing this. Why is it important to have interior contractors on board for the project? And unfortunately, past 40 days, it all looks like the same day. Not getting enough chance to pitch in front of the client. Thank you so much for at least allowing me this chance to tell you the importance of interior contracting. So good morning everyone who are the ladies and gentlemen who have joined us. So tell you about the importance of interior contracting is like when a designer designs a project, he tries to enhance the user experience by managing the space and aesthetics. That is inside an intervened environment. Now, when you have good contractors on board, he kind of syncs that, he understands the intent in a better way, and that's why he is the right fit for the project. Now, let's see what kind of tangible benefits we as interior contractors, a good quality interior contractors brings on board. He, of course, licenses, insurances, the worker compensations, the strategy compliances, everything is something that we definitely bring on board, and most of others do also. But the intangible benefits comes in form of peace of mind that we allow our clients, because we act as a single point of contact for everyone. So there is no blame game going around. Who is the reason because of whom the project is getting delayed? What are the things which are stuck? The general contractors who happens to do the project takes care of all these things himself. They take the onus on themselves to do the project. They have the knowledge of standards, they have the project management experience. And the best thing is that when most of the time clients in a myth that they'll save cost on not having a good contractor, so rather going with the subcontractor, is that they think that they are saving on the cost. But unfortunately, what happens is as a subcontractors, they come for a small period of time for a specific activity and then they go away. So there is no onus on them for to maintain the quality. Whereas the interior contractors, they are the big picture thinkers. They understand the if any actions right now I'm taking for a project, what are the repercussions that are going to happen? If I am not doing something good right now, I have to be there by the end of the project also. That's why maintaining the quality is definitely an essence for a good interior contractor. Also, most of you would agree that nowadays dynamism of contracting has changed. The clients are sitting somewhere else, the designers are sitting somewhere else, and contracting is happening at a site which is maybe a remote location or maybe a location which none of us are there. So it is very important that you have such contractor in place who understand the things, how to manage the offsite activities also. In post-COVID world, in the corona, how can we not talk about corona in such days? Especially after this era, what will happen is that there would be shortage of labor that is going to happen. That's why you have to have a contractor who can manage the offsite activities. He should have a good domain knowledge. He should be an expert in understanding the construction drawings, making the soft drawings and details so that he can take the things offsite. And also he should be one of the enablers who can take advantage of digital mediums, and then the site team, the designers, the clients, they can take decisions on a digital medium. That's why it is all the more important that we have good interior contractors on board. Also, now the good interior contractors and his team also brings a very good domain knowledge of products in the project. Now, if you see the built environment, there are two important aspects of it. One of these is interior designer and second is users. The interior design that we do is the structural element of that built environment, and the moral element is the user. That's why when we say that we make house, and the person who lives in the house makes it a home, the family which lives in that makes it a home. That is the moral element of that built environment. Because ultimately, these are the users who are actually humanizing that space. So there is an interactive relation between this structural element and the moral element, which is user. Now, user, how does he perceive this space? He perceives the space through the interior design, which is a cognitive framework through which he experiences this. And there are two aspects of that also. One is the visual aspect, and second is the ease of use. And in both the aspects, most of you would agree that be it the primary aspect of visual aspect or the ease of use, the selection of product and material plays a very important role. Ultimately, the user is going to get experience of all this. Whatever he's going to experience is going to actually be held on the selection of product and material. Now, going ahead, there are three criteria for selecting a product or a material. One of them is the overall functional criteria, the life of the product, the resistance of the product, the maintenance, ease of maintenance, the safety characteristic, the acoustic performance. Everything comes under this. Second is the aesthetic criteria, that is the color, texture, drawings, patterns. Third is the economic criteria. One of the most important criteria is what is going to be the ongoing cost, the cost that you need to buy it, and also the estimated cost of maintenance, cleaning in the life cycle of the product. When these three criteria marry, then only you finally select the product and material. You have to understand that all these three elements have to be matched, then only it is going to be a good product that you are going to select for the... Now, there is very one important thing that I would like to talk about right now is that when a designer select a particular product and a material, he brings in the aesthetic sense and judgment to use it for the intended purpose. It is the onus of the interior contracting agency, and that's why having a good interior contractor again is very important, that he brings in that knowledge of fundamental characteristic and the practical value of that product and material. If he is not knowledgeable about this, the designs would fail. I'll take few examples here. Now, we as a construction professionals are so accustomed to using the nails for our project or the screws for our project for so long that we don't see adhesives as one of the means of using it in the project. Now, nowadays, there are a lot of adhesives which can be used for the intended purposes. For example, all the things that you see on the screens, like for fixing these applications, maybe tile, maybe wall paneling, maybe signage and all. Most of us might be using it, but I'll show you one of the applications that we as interior contractors have used in one of our projects. Now, this is a project for Savannah Seeds. Now, most of you would agree that for doing a wall paneling, when we use nails and screws, that is very problematic. There, the sign of nails and screws, they stay there forever. And also there are times when it becomes very impossible. As interior contractors, we are an expert in managing the offsite work. If you happen to do this wall paneling offsite, then you have to have a solution so that you can bring it in place and fix it at site. Now, to fix it at site, adhesives comes at a major respite for us. In this image that you're seeing, all the elements that you see, be it the brick cladding, be it the wall paneling that you see, it is for a project called Savannah. So it's a beautifully made office of 10,000 square feet. Herein, everything has been fixed with the help of adhesives. And that's why I say that the adhesives are very important. We have to come out of that habit of using only nails and screws for our project. I'll take, for example, this is a project that we did for William Grant & Sons. This is an award-winning project that we did a couple of years back. It is a small 3,500 square feet of office at Gurgaon. Now, herein also, all the wooden elements that you see on the screen, that is, the wood were cut in size in the factory. We have brought it at site, and then we have fixed it with the help of adhesives. So, that's why I'm saying this. We have to keep investing our time in understanding the new products which are coming on a regular basis. As most of you would agree with this fact that this is a quadrant two activities, which is it's not very urgent, but it's very important. So you'll have to invest your time on a regular basis to understand the new product which is coming up, new material which is coming up, their application in detail, so that when as a designer or as a construction professional, when you use it, it results into a successful project execution also. Now, coming to one of the most important aspects that we talk about is that, now, what happens is that in the project, if we talk of, be it interior designers, we talk of client, or we talk of interior contractor, the worst thing that happens with any project is that we don't communicate enough. Whatever visions we have regarding the project, we need to communicate with others. Setting the expectation right at the time of designing the project. What happens is that as interior designers, very first instance when the client meets us and starts talking about their dream, we start designing the project. But do, as an interior designer, are we setting the expectations right at the initial stage of the project? Are we talking about the cost implication of the project at the time? Are we talking about the timeline that is required? Are we having the honest conversation regarding all these aspects of the project? Because this is very important for successful project execution. We have to have this, especially in the era of COVID now. What will happen is that there is a fear psychosis in everybody's mind. Everybody was trying to save cost in the project. So suddenly, as a designers, wherein just to get a good designs made at site, we used to over-splurge. That kind of things we might not be able to do. So we have the designers with a rational approach for the project would be the ones who are going to win in the longer term now. So it is very important that we set the expectation right at the beginning of the project. Also, everybody, all clients, no matter whosoever the clients, wants a Taj Mahal of his dream as a project. But are he really willing to pay the cost for that Taj Mahal is something that you need to definitely ask. A good project also needs good time. Are we asking for that time from them is something that you should definitely ask. Also, coming to the interior contractors. Now, as an interior contractor also, it is very important for a client to not only have a good interior designers on board. If you want a successful project execution, you also have to have a good interior contractors on board for sure. Why? Because he'll bring in that domain knowledge that is required for the project. Also, most of you would agree with this fact that the projects tend to fail in the initial planning stage only. The client expectation and reality can only marry If the parameters to make it alive are coordinated by the team of experts, craftsmen at the right stage, most of the interior contractors, the mistakes that they commit, or the clients also, if they select to do it themselves, is one of the mistakes they commit is that as a do-it-yourselfer, you should always know that when you don't need to do it. And that is the time that is, for example, I'll take few examples. So, for example, waterproofing is one of the examples that I'll take. What happens is that just to save cost, what we tend to do is that we understand this is the chemical that is going to be used. Why not use it ourselves? Let's have someone who is not an expert in doing the waterproofing. We hand over the chemical in their hand. We hand over the termite proofing chemical in their hand. We hand over the pest control chemical in their hand and ask them to do it themselves. Are we doing it right? These are the places when we need to call in the good quality people who are in this job, specialized for this job, this specialized agency to do it. We as interior contractors always make it a point that we involve good waterproofing agencies, good termite proofing agencies. These small things we take care of because we also are not an expert in doing it. We are rather a team of experts. And every expert has to be handed over the project during the life cycle of the project. They have to be called in and they should be allowed to do the work for so that we can take care of the quality of the product also. Very small example I'll take. See, there are two temptations that we should resist. One is the temptation that I've already talked about. For saving the cost in the project, we should not do it ourselves, just buying the chemical off the shelf and trying to use it yourself. And second is the temptation that we generally as a contractors have, is that saving the cost where things cannot be seen. Because everybody would like to spend money on wallpaper, having a good paint, having a good tile, because these are the things that can be seen. But what about the things which cannot be seen? For example, I'll take one small example of one of the project of ours. This is a project of design code that we did in Moradabad. This is around 18,000 square foot space that we did there. In this space, just because it was done inside an industrial space, there was a lot of places wherein the ducts and the cable trays was passing through the metal elements. Now, I'll just, in this small slide, I'll show you. These are the spaces that will come out. For example, your cable trays and ducts can go through these spaces. Now, as an interior contractors, there are tendency, maybe of the subcontractor, there is a tendency that we don't cover it often, or we do try to cover with it. Let's say, for example, some of the gypsums which is lying on the board, maybe trying to put in there. In the longer run, this is not going to be successful. Now, here the selection of products becomes very important. Why? Now, if we allow the PU foam, right PU foam, which has a fireproofing characteristic also, and we fill up this space, what will happen? If we don't do it, there would be heat loss. Your clients might complain about the heat loss, the air condition not being effective because of that. His voice can be heard in the other room also. That means you lose on acoustics also because of these small things. So, see, that's why I'm saying it is very important that you bring a good interior contractor or an expert at the right stage to do the project. He brings in the good domain knowledge to do the right work in a rightful manner. And ultimately, all these small things that you do at site, using the right product at the right stage, bringing in the right expert at the right stage, will ultimately result into expectations of your clients becoming reality. These are all interrelatable facts. Your client's expectation in terms of quality will not be matched if you are not using the right product at the right time. That's why I always make it a point that have good contractors on board, have a team of specialized agencies doing it for you. They should have the good domain knowledge of the product and material. And finally, they should be willing to invest that little more in getting the right project at the right quality for the client. And then only the expectation of the client can see the reality. With this, I'll hand over to Gopal. Thank you so much. Gopal?
Thank you so much, Anish, for this lovely presentation and couple of pictures, you know, what you have shown. And it is really very, very important, the topics what you have touched, you know, the integrated contracting. It is not only one part of integrated contracting, but you know, it is amalgamated of a lot of other activities which totally, yes, you know, give this job to an architect, and then, you know, or an integrated contractor, and the way they design it, the way they arrange those services, because everything has, yeah, a, and when we talk about especially the difference between the economy and the deliverance and the product, yes, quality, these are three different aspects. You very well, you know, touched all three axes, and you have shown that, you know, what we want, what we design, and what actually comes out, there is always some difference in it. And how you have managed to use a couple of products, and what kind of services and what kind of applicators, so that's what you shared. So our question and answer panel is open. Anybody who wants to ask questions to Ish and to the other panelists and speakers, please feel free to write your questions in the question answer chat box, and we will try to take up your questions at the end of the presentation, because that's what we have done. We have kept 30-35 minutes just for the question answer session, so the experts can answer your questions. I will not take much of time, but anything you need to know about the integrated contracting, or you need any support, you can always get in touch with Anish, who's a professor from IIT Roorkee, and in the service, and the CEO of you also. And now, without wasting much of time, I will go to Gopal. Gopal is a project specialist from Mercuri Sudal, and he has been in this business from last 10 plus years, and supporting project sites and promoting sealant foam synthesis. And then let's hear from Gopal what he has in his basket, and what he's going to talk about is all about sealants, foams, and adhesives, and how you can use it for interior contracting, and how you can get benefit out of it. So over to you, Gopal. I'm going to share the screen with you so that you can. Okay, over to you, Gopal. Gopal, you can share your screen, please. You can see a button on your screen with an option, share your screen.
Is it visible now? Can you see my screen, the PPT screen?
Not yet. You have to share it.
Okay, one second.
Anish, I would request you also to put your camera off. Yeah, Gopal, your screen is visible now. You can proceed, Gopal.
Yeah, okay. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much, Anish ji, for bringing the insights on the various aspects of interior contracting, and emphasizing a lot of on the adhesive parts and the right product for right application things. So just adding on that, I'm going forward with the products and the solutions which I'm bringing from the source of Mercuri Sudal. So I would just start the session with this overview that Mercuri Sudal is a company, wherein Sudal is a Belgium-based company and Mercuri is an Indian company. And we have a joint venture wherein we are supplying the staff machines from here in terms of sealing solutions, gap filling solutions, bonding solutions, and some applications tools as well. So these solutions are being for the exterior part and for transmuted and for other segments as well, but I'm talking clearly about the interior segments, like you have all the tiles and modular kitchens. All these kinds of concepts are there in interior applications. So going forward, we'll see the technology, what all sealants and what all adhesives and what all possible applications we could do with the modern method. So in terms of solutions, if we talk about in sealing solutions, we have sealing category, and then in gap filling solutions, we are doing it with PU foam technology, and we have bonding solutions, which is an hybrid technology, and then we have some applications tools for that. So I'll just quickly run you through with the overview of the company. Sudal, being a European company, is an independent manufacturer, number one largest foam manufacturer in the world, and third largest manufacturer of sealants all across the world. And these are some production sites we have across the world. We have this is a joint venture company between Macquarie Group and Sudal Group, and this is our plant in Babel, Haryana. So now we are coming back to the subject for choosing the right product and for right application. So let's talk first about the sealants part. That sealants are being used nowadays in every aspect. The points which I mentioned here, you can see sealants are now being used on every aspect of the building and the commercial building as well, in the industries, in the doors and facade segments. They play a lot of important role nowadays. Though it is a minor part of the whole project, but it is very, very important part of the building or for a project to get ended well and not to have a cost implication, repair cost implication afterwards. So I'll just quickly share the meaning of a sealant. What sealant does means is that sealant is a paste consistency of material which once comes in contact with the moisture, it gets cured and it becomes a rubber seal. So it becomes a rubber elastic kind of stuff, wherein you can, you know, use to seal the joints. Each and every joints can be sealed using these sealants. It if you see, there are joints like every structure is not same, every surface not same. So there are wood, there are metal, then we have these UPVC windows, aluminium windows in the construction industry. So every surface is different, so the sealant choice should be different as well. So these are some of the problem solvers, like how sealant has come up in our life to become a problem solver for these perfect finishing things. So we are replacing it with the white cement so that crack doesn't appear on certain applications. Then it helps us in creating a water barrier for certain applications for the joints. And then we do get thermal and acoustic insulation properties, as Niji already mentioned in over in slides as well, with some of the product lines. And it's very easy to use, fast, and you can get productive results very fast with this using these products, right products for right applications. So I'll just quickly run you through with the sealants. That in sealant parts, we have four categories, four technologies are available to us. First is silicone sealant. Second one is acrylic sealant. Then we have PU sealant and hybrid sealants. So we'll talk about silicone sealants, which being used nowadays for the construction applications, especially in interior applications. So in market nowadays, we find that in modern method, whosoever is doing at this point of time, that acetoxy and neutral, there are two grades available in the market in terms of sealant. So sealant look like something which you can see over here. It's a bottle. Okay, and it's an silicone sealant bottle, and it comes in two varieties. One is acetoxy and second one is neutral sealant. So suppose this product particularly, which says the acetoxy cure silicone sealant, is only good for glass to glass application. And for other surfaces, wherever you want to seal the joints, then you have to go with the right product in neutral category. A neutral range is different. So let's first talk about why we should not use GP for other surfaces, wherever joint size is there. Like in, if I take example of an UPVC window, so one surface is UPVC profile and second one is the plaster or wall surface. Then if I take a door frame example, then one surface is wood and second one is plaster. So if we talk about particularly in this silicone sealant, it doesn't have a good adhesion with all the surface of the building materials we have. It is only good for glass to glass surfaces, which is not porous in nature, so it doesn't react with the surface over there. Okay, and it doesn't give you a durability and sustainability. So you have to first choose the right kind of silicone sealant for the right application. And there happens that high shrinkage and high smell, the pungent smell is also coming from that sealant cartridges. And due to high solvent is there, once it evaporates, it shrinks. So the cost of rework again comes in. Let's say the life of this product line, if you apply correctly though at the sites, is somewhere around 1 year or 1.5 years. It could happen depending on wear and tear happening at that particular location, particular joints where the stress come in. So this product performs like that. And this is something we have come up with, a neutral range, which is chemically neutral and it doesn't have any acid in it once it's cured. So starting from neutral, then we have other range for specific to UPVC industries. Then there is weather silicon for facade industry. Then we have antifungal solutions for specific for interior antifungal ceilings, like bathroom and kitchen areas are there. Those joints need to be sealed, wherein water should not ingress. So I'll just give you an example. In this slide, if you see, there's a 4-star hotel and there's a bathtub being done nicely. What happened is here, instead of using the sealant, we use putty to fill that joint. And after some time, when the, as you know, the every surface has the breathability and it expands and contracts. So the after having the expansion contraction happened over here, the putty got break. So from there, water started ingressing. And after some point of time, you see, on the other side of the wall, the seepage has started looking. Just imagine, after putting a lot of effort, a lot of labor, the time and everything, and the project timely completion on time, still you are getting these type of problems later on. So this would give you, it would impact certain goodwill aspect for the interior contracting jobs as well. But for the client, is very tedious to get it repaired, and cost of repair is much more than the preliminary stages where we could have used the right product for right application to stop this. So this is one of the example wherein earlier, nowadays we have moved to modern technology. So we have started using silicon sealants in these kind of applications, but still I would like to give you an insight that here in wash basin area or maybe WC areas, we have used white cement. Due to expansion contraction, it happens that it gets cracked. And from the here, the water start ingressing to other part of the area. Nowadays we have the concept of modular kitchens, wherein we spend lots of money. We provide vitrified rights, we lay off the wallpapers and the panelings. All these things we are doing to improvising as per aesthetic looks and to give a rich feel. But if we don't use the right silicone sealant or right product for that application, the disaster result would come up after the project has been started, the position has been given. So this is another application where you could see the fungus in the shower area. Here we are putting a lot of stress. One of the product line that we have to take care of the hygiene part on this thing. If you see the black spot over here in the screen, this is the fungus and it happens. If you don't use the right kind of sealant or maybe you're using putty, then it may develop and it leads to the hygiene problem, as well as first thing you would get maybe is the asthma, the person who's using daily that area, the surroundings, who's living there. This is another example. If you don't use the right product, right antifungal product, right silicone sealant over there for this particular joint to seal the joints, then this would get peel off. The fungus started developing over the sealant and it's easily removable. So this is a look wherein you see the nicely finished with an proper aesthetic look of a silicone sealant. So what a sealant does is it gives you an aesthetic look for that particular area if it's properly tooled and finished, and it should be the right product for right application. I cannot use acetoxy sealant over here because it could react with the tile and a marble surface. And since people are using it to make the food and all things here, so the acetoxy sealant would react with the surface. So that's why here we suggest to use a technology which is having the antifungal properties in it, especially for kitchen areas. So this is another example wherein you can see the aesthetic of, you know, good the look is. We can see the finish of the sealant over here. This is how an application being done at a bathroom site, wherein we have put in the masking tape. On the left hand side, you can see the before application, and on the right side, you can see the after application. So these are another applications specifically to bathroom and kitchen segment areas, wherein hygiene matters. And we have to use the right antifungal silicone sealant for this. We cannot afford to use a normal silicone sealant just buy and use it to save few, you know, money out of it. But later on, we will have to, you know, bear more cost to repair it, and it will hamper the interior contractor's goodwill as well. So this chart would give you an idea why to choose a sealant over white cement applications in the joints. In the joints, we usually preferable to fill the putty and plaster. So after the after a certain point when expansion contraction happens, the crack develops over here. You know, got displaced from the area where it has been filled because it's being rigid in nature. Since sealants are flexible in nature and elastic in nature, it remains over there. The second purpose which we are looking for in an aesthetic, which is getting fulfilled not with a white cement or a plaster surface, but with a silicone sealant, the right sealant filled in the joints. And then we get waterproofing properties as well using that particular joint sealant. So in this video, I'll just give you a glimpse of the areas, how sealant is done, finished, and what all areas we could done in a bathroom segment with a particular antifungal sealant. Okay, now there is another video which shows the kitchen area applications which can be done with the sealant. With that video, I believe you have now got the understanding of some of the application areas where you can see the how sealants being playing an important role to seal those perfect small joints, and it needs to be sealed with the silicone sealant with the right antifungal properties, or maybe if you're using for a cooktop area, for the cooking area around the gas stoves, then you need to go with the high temperature silicone sealant, which should have maybe antifungal properties and at the same point of time high resistance to the temperature as well. So this is another example wherein sealants are being used nowadays for Windows application. Then there are sealants available in neutral range, since silicon sealants has oil which migrates once it's cured after some time due to UV rays putting on it. So what happens is, if you are putting that silicon sealant, especially against the, you are sealing the joint of non-porous material, and in non-porous material, you would find that in porous material, wherein like marble in a special case, if you put the silicon over the period of time, you would see the stain like this. If you see on the slide, here we have put in a silicon sealant in the joint, and you could see the stains coming out of the silicon oil has started migrating towards this porous item, and the marble has absorbed, being porosity in nature, the marble has absorbed the oils from the silicon sealant. So that's why a single silicon sealant cannot be used for a multiple applications. You have to see which product is right for what kind of application. Here's another example which says that oil has migrated. You can see the visuals. And here we have applied a special silicon sealant which has the non-staining, non-bleeding properties and which do the job. So in types of sealants, we have covered the silicon sealants part. Now we are moving towards the acrylic sealant. So this is again a good technology wherein you have small limited movements, joint accommodation joints are there, and you need the paintability options for an interior job. And silicon sealants are not paintable, but acrylic sealants are paintable. So this chart would give you an idea wherein it says that silicon sealants is best in silicon sealants, like silicons being UV resistant properties, and you can go up to 20 mm joints average to seal the joints, any particular joints with silicon sealants, and it's not paintable. But whereas in acrylic sealant, we have the option of paintability, wherein we have the smaller joints, let's say up to 8 mm joints or 6 mm joints or 2 mm joints, you can use this product technology and you can apply over there. Instead of putty, you can use this product line because it has the expansion, contraction, accommodation factor within it. So you can see, I mentioned 15% accommodation factor you can get out of this product line. It can absorb 50% of the accommodation factor from that particular joint size. So these are some of the examples wherein we use this acrylic sealant technology. One of the areas is door frames and wall. Here, if you see, after some time when jerk happens, when we slam the door and jerk comes from the frame to the wall, it passes from the anchor side to the wall. Then what happens is, after some time, you see the hairline cracks being developed from the perimeters of these joints of the doors, especially the area wherein doors is getting slammed. On that side, you will see the crack coming up. So there you can, you know, instead of putting and repairing with a plaster or putty, you can use this product line because it has the flexibility in it. 15% movement accommodation factor is there to seal the joint, and you can paint it over. It can match with your wall. So that's the beauty of this product. Here is another example wherein you can seal the joint with this acrylic sealant and you can paint it over. Another application. And this is one of the applications which Anish already talked about. Here we use the fire-retardant acrylic sealants, including intumescent blankets, which again are based out of acrylics, and then we have a used combination of PU foams, which is fire retardant PU foams. So since sealant part is over, so I'm coming with the technology which is PU foam. Why PU foam is being used in the industry now and why it has to be used more. So PU foam looks like this. It is basically a canister form which has the two propellants are there, which gets mixture and comes out, and it takes a shape like a thermocol stuff, and it fills the joints. It fills the cavities, whatever cavities you have, it fills it. It expands and it completes the void entrapment. So here That's how it looks like. One is straw grade and second one is gun grade. So this slide gives you the idea how a straw grade and a gun grade expands. That's a basic difference between a straw version and a gun grade PU foam. So why we use PU foam is because of these other properties we get. Number one, thermal insulation. Second is the acoustic insulation. And the property which comes handy with this product is it gives the excellent gap bridging property. And nearly 90% of the construction material, it gets adhered to. And it saves the energy because the joints, if you talk about like perimeter joints around windows at the time of summer or winter, they are the joints or small penetrations wherein, you know, you face a lot of heat and cold loss. AC is kind of started and the heat and cold transfer are coming. Outside season is of summer and we have, you know, put on the AC over it. And it's the that particular maybe 5mm or 10mm joint size is there and it's going forward from there. So heat loss and cold loss happens from that area, maybe from the perimeter joints as well. Sound also travels. So that's why this product comes in and plays a major role in stopping that. So this slide would give you an idea. In market, we have this technology available. As per the manufacturing standards, we suggest that how you can identify a good quality of a foam. On the left side, if you see, a PU foam is there, which has large voids over it. You see the cavities, open cavities here. And on the right side, if you see, the cavities have got very minimal. Very small, minute cavities are there. So of course, now from this picture, you can visualize if you are using PU foam already for one of your projects you have already used in past, maybe you can now recollect that what is the importance of a good PU foam application to be done at site. Because if I use a quality like this of a PU foam, then I won't get the thermal and acoustical properties. It may save a few bucks at the time of application, but the idea of putting this product, this technology over a certain certain applications, you won't get it. So these are the multiple applications which you can do with PU foam. One, you can install the door frames nowadays with PU foam technology. Then you can fill the cavities around windows. Then here you can fill around the AC cavities. You've installed, these cavities can be filled. It expands. Once it's extruded from the can, it expands and it takes the shape of that void. And it's covered it completely. So let's talk about wooden frame installation, one of the applications. The conventional method which we used to see at sites earlier is door frame is getting installed on the basis of hole pass, and then slowly and gradually we move to fasteners and anchors. Nowadays, this technology have come in wherein it gives you an extra power of bonding, extra adhesion between both the surface, and to help it make it a monolithic structure. It bridges the gap between two surface. Whatever slam is coming in, and it happens like here, if you put a plaster or putty to repair these smaller joints, and after some time slams comes in, and from here only these things would come out. Because one, it is rigid in nature, and second, it doesn't have a bonding over the period of time with the A surface and the second surface, which is wood. But whereas the PU foam technology bridges both the gaps, it has the both adhesion properties with the wall surface and with the door frames as well. With a standard door frame, you may go with a, let's say if you are using at this point of time four anchor fasteners on each side and on top with two or one, then you can reduce the quantity to two of the anchor fasteners on the either side, and you can use this technology in combination with that, which will give you a proper insulation. One, second, crack won't develop from that particular area anymore. So this is a look wherein you can see how a door perfectly is being installed at site. This is again brick area, and then We have AC blocks also, wherein you can install the door frames using this technology. You have to fill it on the three sides. And that's the final look we get by using this technology. So here's a video wherein it would give you an idea how this product is being used. So that is how this technology is being used. You can, you know, have the aesthetic look at site. There is no need of putting a lot of plaster and water laying off over there. You don't have to repair. And you know, with the let's say less people are there, less labor are there, then you can use that and to, you know, you get the better productivity at particular site using this modern technology. And it saves you cost, a lot of cost, as compared to vis-a-vis with a conventional method using plaster and putty and, you know, getting it treated for 7 days. So here's another application which wherein the, you know, you can use this technology for. You can fill the pipe cavity, it expands and it fills the entire cavity, and whatever excess material is there, you can easily chop it off. And you can, you know, cover it up either with a silicone sealant or maybe waterproofing chemical what you're using for that particular application. And the best part is it comes with an anti-rodent property, so insects and rats won't eat it away. Another application which is window installation. You see the PU foam has been used. Now this video will give an idea about a UPVC window is getting installed at a particular site. How we do it. Now this is how we call a perfectly sealed window. You have spent a lot of money on the correct profile choosement, and you have put it a lot of money over the tiling part and all these things. But if you ignore that small cavity, the perimeter joints of the window, and if you don't fill it with the right kind of solutions, then later on the problem would occur. The heat and cold loss would be there, and water ingress would happen from that area.
Gopal, 6 more minutes to go.
Yes, sir. So these are some of the more cavities wherein you can, the critical areas in the site. So that's getting an ended with the PU foam technology. Now I'm going to talk about the adhesive part, which is very being used in the industry, this interior segment. This is an SMX technology called a hybrid sealant, wherein the beauty of this product is you can bond and you can seal any surface, nearly all the surface in the construction material you have at this point of time for various applications. And one of the application is mirror fixing. Conventionally, what we do is if we put the repeats around and we screw it up and we put a bolt and anchors around it, and we can install this mirror. But nowadays, what happens is we can use this adhesive to bond it, and we can it's ready to use after maybe 2 hours or 3 hours down the day. It's ready to use. Another application here, we can clad the entire wall with this particular technology. Then we can paste the tiles with this technology. These are the overhead applications. Lift area application, wherein you can use this adhesive. And it's a flexible adhesive. Another application, you can bond the natural stone over the staircase with this product. And the beauty of this product is it works underwater. So you would see hardly a product wherein you extrude that product. Let's say here I have taken the example of a mosaic tile repair under the swimming pool. In conventional method, what you have to do is you have to empty the pool. You have to stop the operation over there, maybe for 2 to 3 years and 2 to 3 days over there. And waterproofing guy comes in, and if the operation is not resumed. But in our case, if you use this adhesive, then it's instant. Mosaic tile can be repaired instantly. Person would just have a drip of it. It goes inside. It puts the place where it needs to be replaced with, and it comes out. It will automatically be cured under the water itself. So I'll just quickly run this the last video which I have for this product. I think with that video, I am ending up with my sessions. And I would like to recollect the what Anish ji said during his presentation, that there are a lot of areas wherein we can use the adhesive part instead of nails. So this is one of the video which would give an idea that how adhesive can do that job at sites. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Gopal. Lovely presentation and a lot of topics you have touched upon. I would ask every panelist and all panelists to please switch on their cameras and their mics so that we can take up the question answer, because we've got a hell of a questions. I think Gopal, you can also switch on your camera. Okay, let's take those questions one by one. A lot of technology is being discussed. We have architect over here, we have manufacturer over here, we have Sandeep also there, from Africa, right? So let me start with the first question. The first question is from Milan. Milan has asked, do you think some disturbance is there from somebody? Sandeep ji, maybe it is because from your side. Okay, thank you. We do not use, Milind is asking, how much gap around the pipes or cables can be filled with the soda foam? So this question goes to you, Gopal. What size of the gap, which you can fill up with a foam?
Yeah, so usually at site, let's say 10 mm, 20 mm, or 20 mm, 50 mm gaps are there. So no problem, you can fill that. The only thing we have to see is the after application of that area. If it's a not load bearing application, then you can use this foam. It basically takes the shape of that cavity, it expands, so you can fill that.
Also, the right question to ask is after application, whether we need to paint that area or not, that also has to be kept in mind.
Yes, because of the interior contracting, you have to maybe paint the area.
I'm just coming from that angle. Yes. So, Gopal, you take that also in conversation.
Sure.
Okay, thank you. The next question is to Anish. Anish, this question is from Ankur Bora. And what he's asking, that what is the more durable in wooden ceiling, and that is with adhesive or with screw? He's asking how to fix it up and which one is more durable.
Thank you so much for asking this question. See, as I have initially also I pointed out that we have been conditioned to use nail and screws for years. Since the day, because there is no regular training in this area, what has happened is that we studied in college, we came out, we practiced it, and then we started using nails and screws. Believe me, Ankur, I think there is no difference between using the adhesives or nail and screws. Rather, since the day I started using it, I find it so convenient and it has resulted in so much of offside activity that I just love doing it. And I always think that all these years, why not we were using it? So be it the gap, be it the expansion joint, anything, there is no limitation at all in using the adhesive, as far as I know.
And what is the perspective from Sandeep? Because Sandeep, you have been in the application side.
I would say this will reduce costs, because wherever I have tried it at sites, it has saved cost. Cost doesn't mean the actual value of the product, actual value of your time, because we don't at sites, we don't consider time, value of time. The same work which can be done with by two people in 20 minutes, we keep 4 to 6 people just to fix nails and screws. Two people are holding it, two people are hammering it. One person is standing below and handing over that hammer and nails and screws. So we don't consider that. So then we don't consider the health issues also, rather injuries also. You have screws lying around, you have nails lying around, you are hammering it, someone can get injured. Now this is fast. You just try it and just keep it there. In 10 minutes, it's fixed. So it helps a lot.
Thank you. I would also like to bring in the one important aspect. Thank you, Sandeep, for rightly pointing out. Lot of time in retrofitting and we forget the aspect of reworking cost of things. For example, there is an existing space where you need to fix something and you take nails or screws there to fix a few things. There is a whole lot of reworking cost also around it, which you might not take into account, but you later have to bear that cost also. Adhesive saves you from that as well.
Exactly. So yes. You recommend to use products and especially these sealants or adhesives when you want to compare, it's at a total install cost. So it is going from one pocket. It is not only the product cost, but it is the fixing cost also, or the rework cost. So very, very good, I would say, point. Okay, the next question is from Ayush Saxena. Ayush has asked a question that adhesives which used in a project is, it depends on the price or quality in a project. It's decided by the contractor or who is they want to use, or by architect. So probably he wants to ask, architect decides or contractor decides what to use.
Let me answer this question. Thank you so much, Ayush, for asking this question. Now I'll talk about it in holistically speaking. What happens is that, for example, it does not matter at all who is taking that decision. For even if the architect has rightly mentioned it, even if he has not mentioned it, whether the contractor is the ultimate applicator and he is actually deciding it. What is most important is, did we ask this question from the experts or not? None of us, be it the interior contractor or the architect, are the experts on in these few foams or adhesives. The right approach is to reach out to the expert. They'll ask you the right questions and then they ask you the right suitable product for that application. For example, I'll take few examples. All of us, just to save cost or time, I'll not go into the cost, just to save our time, what we do is we reach out to the market, maybe a hardware store, and go there and ask for a product. Now this is the way the conversation goes. बॉस मुझे ये एप्लीकेशन करनी है, मुझे आई वॉन्ट टू हैंग दिस थिंग, आप मुझे कोई एडेसिव दे सकते हैं? He will give you the adhesive without asking the right questions. If you ask the expert, let's see how the conversation goes. You will say that I need to hang few things. The expert will ask, what is that thing, sir? May I know the weight of it, sir? What is it made of, sir? Is it metal or plastic? And after asking you all the right question, he'll ask you the right product. That's why it is important that whosoever is applicating, does not matter who is doing it, he should ask the experts and then you should decide.
But Anish, that goes for all the products. In fact, in waterproofing industry,
yes.
In waterproofing industry, yes. Person will go to a store and say, Dr. So and so de do. He'll ask his mundu, Raju jara Dr. So and so dena. He will give any pack of Dr. So and so and give it. They will come. They will apply, add cement to it, whether cement is required in that or not. So I have seen people using acrylics where cement is not supposed to be mixed. Still they will add, because उन्होंने देखा है टीवी के ऊपर एड में एक एक्टर बोलता है ये दो प्रोडक्ट लगा लो वाटरप्रूफिंग पूरी. So and when if expert goes, he'll find out about everything. What is the surface? क्यों use करना है? पानी क्या होगा? हर चीज के लिए पूछेगा. So that goes for everything.
Exactly. वो it's very common saying ना. जिसका काम उसी को साजे, अदरवाइज डंका बाजे.
तो गो टू द स्टोर एंड से सिलिकॉन दे दो.
या
माइंड कहेगा
सिलिकॉन का है. हां, ही विल गिव यू अ रेडीमेड सॉल्यूशन फॉर एवरीथिंग.
यू राइटली सेड
सर. सो एनीथिंग व्हिच इज इन दिस ट्यूब इज अ सीलेंट, इज अ सिलिकॉन. अ ट्यूब लाइक दिस विल हैव सिलिकॉन. सो आप ये रखोगे, कस्टमर देखते हैं, अच्छा आप सिलिकॉन लगा रहे हो. So these tubes have become like, that's the,
yes, a common derivative, jo ki log site ke upar use karte hai, kuch bhi le aao to wo sealant hi hai. To har jagah pe same sealant lagane ki koshish hoti hai, but as Anish rightly said that, let's ask from the expert and it doesn't cost you anything because you are just taking an advice and probably you can use a right product, it could last forever, or maybe I won't call it a forever, but with the durability. Okay, let's move on to the next question. The next question is from Krishnan Narayanan. That question is again to Anish. Anish, Krishnan is asking, what are the key challenges that an interior contractor faces during the execution phase, and how does a contractor deal with client proposed changes at site? That's a very valid question.
I'll speak about the challenges which interior contractor faces on a regular basis. There are two questions in this. The second aspect is about the change orders. First, I'll stick to the first one. Now, generally what happens is that once a designer thinks of a design, there is a clear intent of his design, he sends to the site. Normally, the very first challenge that we as interior contractors face is whether the design that has been given, the drawing that has been given, is actually suited for the site or not. That is the first thing that we study in detail. For example, there can be minor changes that is required in the drawing because of the site condition. There are a lot of things that revolves around the site conditions also. Second thing is, we also have to think from an angle that whether the thing that is being proposed actually is right suited for that particular environment, the end user perspective or not. As I have said during my presentation also, designer, while giving you the design, thinks from an aesthetics and the ultimate intention of the client, the end user's intentions. We as a contractors will also have to understand that thing from the user's perspective, the longevity of the product, and how the use of that product is going to shape the experience of the end client. So there are a lot of time when you will see there is a difference between what is being proposed is not right fit for the project. You will have to take this knowledge to the designers, talk to the architects, talk to the clients, why you feel that this might not be the right suit, and get it changed. And third important aspect, because there are a lot of issues I can keep going on and on, but third important aspect also is, for example, as a contractor, what we do is we try to do a lot of activities offsite. We also happen to own our own factory setups. That's why we try to do it offsite. In doing the things offsite, we also have to think in the manner that whether the design that is being proposed is modular or not, so that we can take it into production. The ease of production also has to be taken into account. So for the ease of production, if something has to be changed, we reach out to the architects and designer at the right stage and we get it changed, and so that the things can be done in the timeline, within the timeline, because everything boils down around the timeline. If I have maybe a year to do a project, my way of approaching the site would be totally different. If I have only 2 months to do the site, then my way of approaching the things and thinking of the design would be different. So these are major aspects that I can talk about right now. These are three elements that are majorly important.
Yeah, I fully agree with you, Anish, that nowadays the time is utmost important, and especially time-bound projects where you have to use the new technology. Otherwise, if we talk about in the past, 20, 30 years ago, we never thought of drilling machines. We never thought of, backhoes. We never thought of the gizmos and technologies what are being used in foundation construction and all those. So now if we compare, after 20 years, we are far, far, far ahead of, using those technologies. And we have seen the time. It started, this innovation started with the Delhi Metro. I would give this credit to Delhi, because when this construction era started, they were the first one to bring civil engineering to that level, where they showed, the kind of speed, production capabilities, aesthetic, and deliverance, because everything went on time. So from there, the civil engineering started. And now we are talking about all civil engineering and interior, because everything is related to construction. So we are talking about interiors, we are talking about buildings, we are talking about structure. Yes. So that is what we really want to aspire to, this new technology. And it is good that you have mentioned this point. We move on to the next question.
I would also like to touch upon one thing, because I think there are a lot of budding architects and construction professionals here attending this session, that just now that you mentioned that Delhi Metro was pioneer in attracting the new technology, using that in the project, is also because a lot of international consultants and architects, if you see, they invest time in reading about all this. That's why I'll request all the budding interior designers, all the practicing interior designers, or the construction professionals to invest some of your time in getting to know about the new products which is coming in the market. understand that, so that at least when you need that, you will have something in mind, you will reach out to the right expert at the right time. If you don't invest time in doing all this, you will not get to use this.
Thank you Anish for answering that. The next question is to Gopal. Gopal, this question is from Ankur Vora. Can we use neutral silicone sealant in toilet flooring to decrease seepage?
Yes, you can use, but with antifouling property, and it's not related to seepage. It's a more kind of waterproofing subject. We cannot recommend without seeing the situation exactly. But on the joints, if you're talking about the corner joints, then you can seal it with the sealant, right kind of sealant over there.
Okay, Sandeep, yeah, I would say that
this can only be a preventive measure. This can be a preventive measure. If the seepage, see, the seepage in bathroom or kitchen floors is normally not from the tile joints. The seepage is because your slab has already failed. So even if you repair the tile joints and don't allow water to go below that, your area between the tiles and floor slabs, which could be anywhere between 2-3 inches to 9 inches, there is already water accumulated there. The problem is in that area. So you have to seal the mother slab, seal the joints from where your drain pipes are going out. All those areas you have to seal. And only then seepage will stop.
Right. So it is not only the treatment.
Yes. Yeah. If the water is going from the tiles, if you can identify that, yes, rejoint the tiles and use a sealant on the edges. Water will stop going there from there at that moment. But slowly, if the seepage is from some other area, it will go. And once the seepage has entered the, if the water is already accumulated in the sunken area, it will go down. It will go down. Yep. You can't avoid it. Right. So that's why most of the new properties which are coming up, the sunken, instead of sunken slabs, there are flat slabs. So there's no pipe in that area. The pipe, a cutout is taken from a cutout. The pipes are taken below the slab. So underhand piping is there. So there, if seepage is from the pipe, it will drip on the ground one floor below that particular bathroom or kitchen. So इसीलिए जितने भी अब नए buildings apartments आ रहे हैं उसमें अगर bathroom में fall ceiling जो pieces लगे होते हैं उनको हटा के देंगे तो pipe जा रही है वहाँ से. And if it start dripping, leaking, then the person who is living on the upper floor, he is not affected. The person who is living on the floor below, जिसके घर में पानी टपक रहा है, वो ज़्यादा effect होता है. So for that, other things have to be done. Only sealants won't work.
So you have to feed
the sealants. Sealants are part of the package.
Exactly, part because of the, if there is no ingress of water, so seepage won't come. But if it is already a seepage, then you have to treat the mother slab and then finally cover it, finish it with a sealant.
Yes.
Okay. We move on to the next question now. That is from Tushar Munshi. Do you recommend sealants in the horizontal tile joints? If yes, which sealants do you recommend? Gopal?
Horizontal tile joints, right?
Tushar is a very senior waterproofer based out of Pune.
Ah, okay. So you know him. Waterproofing connecting to the right person. Okay. Gopal?
Yeah. Horizontal joints. Yeah, you can apply in horizontal as well as vertical joints of the surface. Doesn't matter it's tile or it's marble, but you have to choose the right product for that kind of application. Of course, for a certain applications, you cannot replace the grout over there if you're applying grout over there. So this is not the replacement for the grout, but this is the area wherein joints are more and movement happens more. You can arrest that using these sealant products over there. So again, I would insist that it depends on the site conditions for what actual application you are looking for from that particular area. Then only we can suggest, is it a grout, is it a sealant, or it is a waterproofing subject altogether.
Okay. I have another question from Sahil, which is in line with this. Does it require curing as well? Means sealants, does it require curing for the sealant as well, Gopal?
No, sealant doesn't require any. Yeah, usually sealant, these products are moisture curing products. The ones which I have showed in my slides. So it takes the moisture from the air and it starts getting curing. And usual time for any general silicone sealant based out of normal ambient temperature is 2 mm per 24 hours. So the first layer of the 2 mm of that bead, whatever you joint you're putting in, maybe 5 mm depth or 10 mm depth, it depends. So it will take the time according to the ambient temperature around it, environment.
Okay, the next question is about PU foams. The question is, can PU foam be used as a backup packer for expansion joints? How good it is for waterproofing? This is again from Tushara.
Okay, so yes, Tushaji, we can use the PU foam as a backer rod material because ultimately the purpose of sealing that expansion joint is going to be either with mechanical or with a sealant bead. PU foam or a backer rod is just playing a secondary role just to have a backing for that sealant or material to not fall off from that area. It is acting as a barrier give a supporting for that sealant to be there until it gets cured and it takes its final shape over there for that particular joint. And to be precise, we recommend a PU sealant or a technology wherein we say up to 40 mm design joints only we recommend using the sealant. And you can use, instead of backer rod, you can fill the PU foam over there.
Okay, Gopal, the next question is again about the PU foams. Can we use it for electrical or plumbing chiseling?
Yes, you can. You can. It is one of the good applications in the interior application wherein you apply this foam, it expands and it takes that area. And the beauty of this product is you can top it up with the plaster and putty also, and the crack won't happen from that area.
Because if you recommend everyone to use it. Sorry yeah. To interrupt you.
Please, Anish. Yeah. Actually, we have the possibility of time.
From my experience, I strongly recommend everyone to use it. Because a lot of time what happens is that because of poor workmanship that we try to fill it with cement mortar, because of poor workmanship, a lot of time what happens is that I'll talk about the contractor's perspective. When you do all this chiseling, who gets to fill the cement mortar? Generally, the electrician and the plumber there who has done the work try to do it. They are not an expert in doing that. What happens afterward is that once you do the POP on top of it, there are cracks developing in it. This right. thing, this using of PU foams there solves all the problems. Strongly, I'll advise to use it.
Hey, who, thank you. After your air conditioning, conducting, after electrical conducting, after your plumbing, when the mortar is applied, who cures it? No one has time to cure it. A plumber won't cure it because he says, "Mera ye kaam nahi hai." The electrical contractor won't cure it. Uska bhi kaam nahi hai. Then the bond between the PVC pipe, CPVC pipe, UPVC pipe, whatever pipe is there for these, there is no bonding between cement mortar and that plastic pipe. So again, for air conditioning, the foam which is there is no bonding with it. So end of the day, what they do, they murga jali lagate hain, murga jali lagane ke baad plaster kar dete hain, and they say it is going to be okay. But curing fir bhi nahi karte. And अगर curing कर भी देते हैं, over curing कर देते हैं, तो वो that मुर्गा जाली, it gets rusted. They are cracked exactly. Because of that. So this is the best for that application.
Okay, thank you so much for enlightening this particular point. There is another question from Sahil. Can we use or apply sealants on wet surface, or is it required to apply it only dry surfaces?
Very good question. Silicone sealants usually we prefer to apply on the dry surface only. If there is a wet surface, it needs to be directed that it has to be dry before applying that. But yes, there are exceptions. If the surface is slight moist, you may go with the hybrid technology instead of silicone sealant technology. Hybrid technology has the property which works underwater and even on wet surfaces also. But we have to see कि वो एकदम dry वाला surface नहीं होना चाहिए, हल्का moist होगा, जो बाद में चला जाए, उस जगह पे आप इसको use कर सकें।
Thank you, Gopal. The next question is again from the same domain, but it is from PU foam and sealant. The question is, we do not need use hole pass and fasteners in door frame if we use the sealant and the cushion. So I think what he wants to say is that do we really need to use a hole pass if we use sealant and foams?
Yeah, see, it depends. We cannot say ki hole pass ko replace karna hai ya fastener ko replace karna hai for this kind of application. It totally depends on the what kind of application you're looking for. Is it a structural application or is it a furniture element of that area? Agar aap door frame ka as a furniture element leke chal rahe hain usme and it's not a structural element over there, then you can this use this product line. It bonds. Suppose main example leta hu, 7x3 ki chaukhat hum lete hain aur usko hum bond kar dete hain stand alone with PU foam. Wo bond le lega. बट अगर चौखट में लोड ज्यादा पड़ रहा है डोर में डबल डोर्स आपकी बात कर रहे हैं या बड़ा डोर हो गया है तो उस जगह पे हमें कैलकुलेशन देख के हमें इसको यूज करना पड़ता है तो आई कैन नॉट रिकमेंड स्टैंड अलोन कि सिर्फ पीयू फोम के बेसिस पे ही दरवाजा टिक जाएगा देयर आर चांसेस कि वो टिकता है बट वी हैव टू सी द साइट स्पेसिफिकेशंस अकॉर्डिंग व्हाट आर द रिक्वायरमेंट्स ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर साइट
Like Anish said, you know, ask from the experts. If you have any query regarding, you know, fixing up the anchor fastener on the door frame or, you know, whether we should use it or not, because everything will cost you something. You know, chahe wo anchor fastener hai, chahe wo foam hai, chahe wo sealant hai. So I think that's a right, valid point which Gopal, you mentioned, that every site condition is different. And we take the call based on what is the size of the chaukhat, take the, you know, the loading also. We also see that whether the chaukhat is you know embedded in the floor also. So there are a lot of factors. That is what is important. Okay. So next question. We will move on to how much area needs to be covered with sealants while fixing tiles. Milan. Gopal.
So what was the question? I couldn't get it. Can you please repeat it?
How much area needs to be you know covered with on the tile if you want to fix up the tiles.
ये डिपेंड करता है कि कौन सी टाइल है सो अगेन आई वुड रिएटेट माय स्टेटमेंट कि वो साइट कंडीशन डिपेंड करता है एप्लीकेशन पे टाइल का वेट कितना है कितनी उसकी थिकनेस है अकॉर्डिंगली वी डिसाइड व्हाट इज द बीड ऑफ सीलेंट और एडहेसिव टू बी अप्लाइड ओवर देयर और उसके लिए एवरी मैन्युफैक्चरर इवन अस आल्सो वी गिव द प्रॉपर कैलकुलेशन सीलेंट्स एंड फोम्स आर अवेलेबल प्रॉपर कैलकुलेटर्स आर अवेलेबल अंटिल अनलेस आई नो द वेट ऑफ द स्टोन पर्टिकुलरली आई कैन नॉट से कि ये सीलेंट का 5 mm का बीड है या एडहेसिव का 5 mm का बीड है और लग गया और आपका पत्थर चिपक गया ऐसा नहीं होता है सो उसमें कितना लोड पड़ेगा अंदर है बाहर है ये कंडीशन भी मैटर करती है सो देयर आर वेरियस फैक्टर्स व्हिच इंक्लूड्स फॉर दिस पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट टू डिसाइड
Finally, I have a very interesting question. Can we use sealant instead of tile grout? And what is the difference in its cost? This belongs to, you know, everybody when the question about cost and contracting and, you know, because ghoom phir ke sab kuch quality, ye wo sab kuch baat ki baat hai. Pehle aap price batao ji, kitna lagta hai. So, Anish, you would answer. Probably, I will take it in a sense ki, tile grout or sealant ki cost mein there is a difference. How would you justify it to your client, you know, if you have to use or do you recommend to use only tile grout or combination of tile grout or sealant? That's what is it.
See, I would rather recommend to have a balance between the grout and the sealant, especially on the corners. I would recommend to use the sealants basically, and all other joints can be filled with the grout. That is my recommendation.
I think Niranjan, you got your answer. That you know, वो कहते हैं जितना चीनी डालो या मीठा उतना ही होता है, गुड़ डालो उतना ही मीठा होता है. So what actually client you know wants that they want gold out of everything. So now it is a balance that how you can provide that gold with your limited resources and what kind of money they are paying to you, and you can also show the difference. You know, if you use a sealant, then what kind of life expectancy you have and what kind of fixing, you know, aesthetic, like what Anish said in his slides. Aesthetic is very important when you're doing the interior contracting. And if you don't use that, how it looks like and what are the possibility that tomorrow there could be some kind of a water ingress through those joints. So that you can highlight. Right. I think if it is a question of only, you know, per square meter, some 2 rupees or 3 rupees or 4 rupees, something like that, nobody would say no to it. provided it is shown in the right sense and through architect, I think that's a right place, because we have an architect who does an interior contracting also. So I think we are distinct from him. So that's.
I have a question, Nitin. Can we use any of these sealants as active tile grouts? Because I have not seen in the portfolio a product which can be used as a tile grout. Because see, these tile grouts, if you use an epoxy tile grout, it has a long life.
Right.
But if you use a sealant has to be removed after two people, because people don't understand it and they don't realize that sealant is not installed for the lifelong. It is, you have to remove it after 3 years, 4 years, and take it out and reseal it. So that's right. A process.
Right. No, very valid question, Sandeep. I would say. I would answer it in two manners. Gopal, if you allow me.
Yeah, please.
A lot of products in our basket, and I'm sure, in this market, you have experienced a lot of product range, especially fixing up the tiles. So one way is fix up the tiles, and second way, is to fill the joint with the tiles. We do not recommend to use or replace epoxy grouts or tile adhesives or grouts with sealant. No, we wouldn't recommend that. What we recommend, that wherever you see the possibility of the movement, where you use sealant, especially on corner joints. And if you have an area where you are doing the vertical cladding, the slab weight is more, and you want to redo the job, renovate the bathroom or kitchen on a cladding, dry cladding, there you can use sealant. But we recommend that all the joints should be filled with the cementitious product itself, because we cannot take the place of, in all the civil activities. It is how you should see it as a balance between, like Anish said, a balance between the economy and the application, the product. So everything I can do, like I always give an example that, when you have to fix up two papers, you normally try to use a normal gum. You will not use Fevicol, you will not use a sealant, but they can also do the job, but you will not achieve the economy. So as an interior contractor or interior contracting jobs, there should be a right balance with the product you choose and the application, and at the same time, the economy, what price, what you are delivering. So that's a balanced approach which should adopt. But we have those products which can be used. We have a cementitious product range also in our banner, which we are not right now promoting in India, but in Sudal, we have that.
Thank you.
Okay, I hope I have answered your question. And now we move to next question. Next question is from Rahul Bansal. How is the interior contracting absorbing the impact of COVID-19? I think this question goes to Anish. COVID-19, you mentioned.
See, as far as absorbing the impact is something that we are also right now studying. But I can definitely touch upon the facts wherein we think that there are going to be changes. For example, I mentioned that there is going to be shortage of labor for sure. That is going to be there for times to come. So what will happen is that a lot of activities of site will have to happen off-site. So that shift in the mindset in the contracting has to happen. So in this time, especially those contractors will survive who have the ability to do the offsite work, who have their own factory setups. So that, because timeline for the project, I don't think any client is going to negotiate on that particular thing. Because ultimately it boils down to retailers, the owners or developers allowing it to their clients or not. If they don't allow it, obviously because there is revenue loss. So you have to do the work within the same timeline, maybe 2 or 3 months that you allowed. And with the less labor, you can actually have to take help from the factory to get it done. That is one thing that, of course, I'm seeing. And the second cost, of course, in that particular area, there has to be less number of labors because of social distancing norms. So you'll have to maybe in 2 or 3 shifts, you'll have to do the work. Because of people, lesser number of people there being there, you have to develop a ways and means by which you can become more efficient. So those are the things that of course, all these changes I can foresee. As far as the cost implication is concerned, I think I also need to study a lot. Maybe I'll be in a better position to answer this once I do one or two sites after COVID. But these are the things that I see as immediate change.
Scarcity of the manpower, the laborers, they have already moved to their hometowns. So that situation would be there. But that is the real situation, and we are also taking all the precaution and directives, whatever government is laying down, and we are abiding by the all directives. So it is very difficult to analyze the situation now, but yes, there will be an impact. So okay, so we have a lot of questions. I could say that there are 30-40 more questions which we cannot take due to the paucity of time. I will take the last two questions, so that rest of the questions, what we will do, we'll share with the panelists, and we request them to please answer them one on one. Okay, the next question is, how long after fixing a looking mirror with sealant it can sustain? Nirmal Agarwal.
It depends what is the product you have used for, and what is the wear and tear at particular site over there is happening for that area. But usually if we say that we don't do any activity use particular mirror ko lagane ke baad, and if you have used the hybrid sealant technology over it, so we say until renovation of the building you can be rest assured that the product won't go off, but you have to use the right product for that area.
There is another question which is from Mr. P. V. Raman from Chemitech Engineering, Kolkata. Does this sealant bond well with any paint or finish for fixing mirror or heavy wall hung object as shown in the video? Well, that's basically yes. Fix all video which was shown.
Fix all video.
No? Just there is an addition to it is also from P. V. Raman. Is there is any limitation of substrate for bond? So I think you can answer both of these aspects.
Yeah. Ultimately, if you go back to the principle of any adhesive to get an adhesion for the surface, it clearly says ki A surface or B surface apni jagah se nahi hatna chahiye. First thing, if one is let's say mirror and second one back of the surface is a plaster surface jisme plaster theek nahi hai ya painted surface hai, or after movement expansion contraction would happen, that paint surface would leave that surface itself. So it's not a failure of adhesive or a silicone, it's a failure of a surface, first thing. Second thing, you talk about the mirror coating. Yes, for looking mirror we have 5 mm, 6 mm tak ka coating hota hai uske piche, and we have to use the right sealant for that or right adhesive for that. As I mentioned, there are two ways to apply it. Abhi usually kya hota market se store mein leke aaya, jaise already panelist we were discussing that ki market mein gaye aur humne ek silicone ki bottle li, wo silicone lagaya, GP silicone liya aur laga diya. So there are two grades of sealants. One is acetoxy and second one is neutral. Acetoxy agar main lagata hu to piche ka jo black surface jo painted hai wo kuch samay baad wo kha jata hai. You can easily see the spots happening because of that wrong sealant being applied over there. In neutral sealant also, because sealant doesn't have the property of adhesive, it cannot replace the bonding agent. So that's why we recommend the hybrid technology is best for doing these kind of jobs, not sealant. Sealant is good to seal the joints.
Okay, I think those are all the questions, but there is one very interesting question which I could not hold myself back without asking all of the panelists. And this special question is for I would really ask Sandeep to answer that question. Sandeep, this is because related to waterproofing. The question is from Aniket Mahajan, that we use DPC during construction, then why is the need to deal with the sealants after years? Can't we put some better things during the construction? So I think perfect for you to answer.
Please come again. What's the question?
Aniket is asking about if we are using DPC during the construction, then what is the need to deal with the sealants after so many years? And can't we put some better things during the construction? So sealant ko use na karna pade? Please answer.
Sealants, DPC, waterproofing products, these are all different. DPC I think is the lowest product in waterproofing, aur usko bhi log theek se nahi karte hain. So that's why we have every year we deal with at least if not less 50 to 60 sites where the problem is of DPC failure, where the problem is of rising dampness. You go to any construction site in Delhi NCR, a house which is built for 5, 4, 5 years, But there's the problem of rising temperatures. Why? No one knows how to do DPC. अगर DPC के स्पेसिफिकेशन आप देखोगे तो no one is following those specifications. People are still using cheapest polymer available in market, whether in powder form or liquid form, using it with cement without checking the cement water ratio and applying it at DPC. So DPC and sealants, they have nothing to do. Sealants are applied at different places, DPC at different place, and waterproofing again different thing. So sab cheeze, ye teeno cheeze zaruri hain. DPC apni jagah zaruri hai, uske baad waterproofing karni apni jagah zaruri hai, aur sealants jahan lagane wo apni jagah zaruri hai. Teeno ka apna role hai. So agar main building enveloping ki baat karunga, so all these products are these are elements of building envelope. So DPC, a good DPC protects rising the building from rising dampness or water coming from the below ground. Now, and your good coatings, waterproofing coatings on a terrace, protect the building from any seepage from the roof. And a good anti-carbonation paint on the outside of the building protects it from the seepages and cracks in the walls. And the sealants at various, let's say, sealants are for your window joints, sealants are for your any exhaust which is coming out to sealing that area, sealants are for your skylights, sealants are used for your air conditioning. So there are various places and various type of sealants, as we have been listening. So many type of sealants are there. So every product has its own importance, uses and life. So sealants have to be maybe redone after a couple of years. Waterproofing, normally a good waterproofing done is for 10 to 15 years. The design is for 30 years, but you need not, it doesn't mean that you have to do it after 30 years. But the guarantees are normally given for 10 years. So every product has different application. The only thing is you have to use a right product, right application, right applicator. These three things are important.
I would also like to talk from my experience of contracting. I think a major mind shift has to happen in India as far as we are related to the use of chemical in construction industry is concerned. Why I'm saying this, if you see, first I'll talk about the total cost of the project vis-a-vis the cost of waterproofing, the cost of termite proofing, and the cost of LSF pest control. Total, it may not even account to 0.5% of the project cost.
Yes.
Exactly. How do a client and consultants and contractors approach this is that we all try to save cost in there. Maybe we'll just buy the chemical from there, use it, may not be using the right chemical at the right place also. That's why I'm saying the major mindset should happen. What should rather happen is that every client, every interior designer, every architect should rather go in detail and understand about the use of chemicals at the right place. We should not allow the wrong chemicals to be used in the property at any point of time, because ultimately the impact of this later on when you do spend your money on the reworking, all the lifetime savings, all the desires of your dream project of yours goes for a toss if you want to save cost here. And those are the costs that you try to save without going into the detail of it. Aap compare karte ho, usne to 8 rupees ka cost diya tha, wo 10 rupees ka de raha hai. Without going into detail ki wo kya chemical use kar raha tha, uska kya impact hoga, ye sab koi study hi nahi karta. That shift, major shift in the mindset has to happen.
Very rightly said, I think Nanish, and to summarize everything, घर बनाया जाता है लोगों के रहने के लिए. अनीश ने अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन में शुरू में बात भी की. We don't only talk about aesthetic, we also talk about the users, who are going to use that premises or house. It is very important that what you are using may tomorrow impact their health also. Like Gopal talked about sealants, hygiene, anti-rodent properties of foam, and किस तरह से आप कर सकते हो, किचन को किस तरह से कर सकते हो, स्विमिंग पूल को किस तरह से कर सकते हैं. संदीप टॉक्ड अबाउट कि सीपेज है तो अस्थमा की प्रॉब्लम्स हो सकती हैं, वाटर प्रूफिंग क्यों जरूरी है. अनीश एज एन इंटीरियर कॉन्ट्रैक्टिंग एंड आर्किटेक्ट टॉक्स अबाउट हाउ यू नो दिस एंटायर सिनेरियो वर्क्स. इट इज नॉट ओनली 0.5% ऑफ द टोटल इंस्टॉल्ड कॉस्ट, टोटल कॉस्ट ऑफ द प्रोजेक्ट, बट एवरीबडी ट्राइज टू सेव सम मनी ओनली व्हेन इट इज नॉट सीन. क्योंकि जो पीछे लग जाता है दीवार पे किस तरह से चिपका या नीचे क्या लगा उसको कोई दिखता नहीं, सिर्फ एस्थेटिक में सामने दिखता है कि कुछ लगा है तो उसकी वैल्यू नजर आती है. सो प्लीज डू नॉट कट कॉर्नर्स एंड द ऑडियंस हु इज लिसनिंग, वी आर गोइंग टू वाइंड अप दिस सेशन. We will be coming up with some more interesting topics. The next topic, what we are thinking, is about renovation of kitchens and bathrooms. So that is a very interesting topic because a lot of money is being spent on these two areas. It's spent from, $50 to maybe 50 lakh rupees in a bathroom and kitchen. So it all depends on what kind of, fixtures you are going to do and how you are going to do it. But ultimately, कभी भी problem आती है तो जो सारा दोष है वो जाता है कि इसने काम ठीक नहीं किया and who should take the ownership. So we will talk about all these topics in our next webinar, which will happen on Wednesday, same timing, 11:30 to 1. Sorry, we have missed the timeline because we are 15 minutes surpass our time, which next time we'll take care of because so many interesting questions. And thank you to all the panelists, Anish, Dino.
I'll take 30 seconds. See, a family building a good house in Flinders Square Yards. In each bathroom, they spend somewhere around minimum 5 lakhs to 20 lakhs on tiling, on sanitary ware, on jacuzzi and various things. The waterproofing and sealant in that bathroom that would not cost more than 13,000 rupees. Upper limit would be 18,000 rupees. That's maximum. A person will fix a tile worth 600 rupees square feet in that 6 by 10 bathroom. If the cost of that tile will be 6 times than the total waterproofing and sealant cost.
Right.
I have received a few messages from some of the people who are attending. They want us to do a special session for their architects, and they want us to do special session for their architectural teams in their office, between 5 to 15 people, 20 people. They can send us their details. We can fix up a time and we can do a special session on sealants and adhesives and waterproofing for them, a training session, which will be more of an interactive training session, question answer session. We can fix up a time for them and do it. So thank you for attending today's session. Thank you.
Thank you everybody for joining in, and I would like to thank also WFM Media. You can find our webinars and recording of this webinar on our website. You can go to www.mekoisdal.com and there is a webinar page and you can click on that and you can download the recording also. Similarly, SNP is also working on to add a webinar page and you can download the recording. And for any specific question, please get in touch with us. You have our email IDs. We would love to support you with the best possible capabilities of ours. Thank you so much, Anish. Thank you so much, Gopal. And thank you so much, Sandeep, once again. Stay safe, stay at home, घर में रहिए, अच्छे घर में रहिए जिस पे सब कुछ अच्छे से किया हो और सुरक्षित रहिए. थैंक यू सो मच.
थैंक यू. बाय बाय.
थैंक यू. बाय बाय.